why we're here. We've been here for going on 15 years next summer. Next June will be our 15th anniversary. Mike, where are we at on visitorship?
Probably somewhere around 57,000, 58,000.
So probably in the next year or so, maybe in the next year, we'll crack the 60,000 mark. It's a great 12, although we do get, you know, all kinds of groups, college students, senior groups, so on and so forth. But without a lot of you, I'm going to let Denise introduce Steve, and then we'll get on with it.
I'm going to introduce Steve, and Steve's going to introduce me.
That's right.
This is Steve Kendrick. He's the person who's speaking to you tonight about his work on using coronagraphs to detect exoplanets. Planets on Earth outside of our solar system. The race is on to be the first to find one that, you know, definitely has all the attributes that can support life. So it's pretty exciting that's happening. Steve is a scientist. He can tell you a little bit more about what he studied in college more briefly, but he's constantly discovering and working. He's a scientist and an engineer combined, really. He's a pretty wonderful guy.
So Steve, no differential equations, please.
Say that for the question.
I left out the error budgets, the flow charts, all the normal stuff that we would typically show and try to wall people in.
This is not a critical design review.
And Denise developed most of the charts that you see here. She's spent a lot of time collecting pictures of different coronas and photographs and all, so and working for things so that you actually have hands on. So afterwards we'll be able to try using occulting disk and see how many planets you can see around a bright star or your 60-watt light bulb, whichever. Depends on if you want to look through the telescope while you're flying either of this first or last.
So kids and everybody, I have lots of handouts and mini posters and James Webb tattoos and NASA stickers and Spacey stickers. So I hope afterwards you come up and spend some time, adults and kids, taking turns going upstairs, but also taking turns coming up here to do some of these activities. And I have little forms when you're done, if you don't mind, just checking off yes, 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 if you like things and you didn't like things, because you folks give us lots of great ideas to do for activities like you know, kids like and don't like. And if you fill out a little questionnaire, you get a special little ball notebook in addition to these giveaways up here. So the special giveaways are in a special box, which you get after you do your little questionnaire, because that info helps me and I have to turn it in to NASA so they know what we're doing. Now let's see if we can.
Okay. I've been fortunate to work at a number of optical companies. I've worked at PerkinElmer on Hubble Space Telescope. I started there about 2 weeks after they started on Hubble. And I've been going to other companies. And also worked some on Kepler and more recently on some of the mirror technology for James Webb Space Telescope. So we'll talk a little bit about Kepler and how it's finding exoplanets. And about what JWST will do in the future. And you know, get into a little bit about what exoplanets are and what they're going around and different ways to find them, and also talk about solar eclipses, things that you can do also. So we're going to start out with a movie that's talking about exoplanets and the excitement. The first exoplanet was found in 1995 around a star like our sun, a main sequence star. So that was the first time. So it's less than 20 years since people have said, yeah, we told you they're probably around there. And next it would be, and there probably was like Earth. And gee, it looks like they're in the habitable zone where there could be liquid water and life developing. And so that's what people are looking for now. Kepler has some candidates now that are actually Earth size or smaller than Earth, even down to about the size of Mercury. So there have been a lot of exciting discoveries in the recent years. When I was growing up, didn't think that there were billions of galaxies. We knew the Milky Way galaxy, but to think that there are many more, means that there could be billions of galaxies, and a galaxy could have billions of planets, billions of stars, and now we know it could have billions of planets too. That's one of the things that Kepler was looking for, was to get a feel for what's the probability of finding another planet around another star of a certain type. What type of stars should we look for? Should we look for ones that are of the type like our sun, ones that are close to our sun, the red giants? Should we look at ones that are maybe a couple of million years old? We look for certain properties in the spectra to get a feel for how developed they are. Is this loud enough?
No.
Okay. Okay, is that better?
That's better.
Great.
Okay.
Thanks.
I think part of it is that I've got to turn to the left. So, this way. Depends on whether I'm looking at this or looking at you. So what we wanted to talk about tonight is about these planets around other stars, not just around our star, but we'll talk about our star and our planets. Also, we may talk a little bit about how many planets we should have in our solar system. And then the ways that we're searching for exoplanets. There are a number of different methods that are being used to find exoplanets. And there are difficulties in some of this. The exoplanets are dim compared to their stars. Telescopes have imperfections, so that makes it difficult to tell, is it something real or is it not? A real planet is an artifact of the instrument. We've got scattered light in our solar system, zodiacal light. There's zodiacal light or exo-zodiacal light around other stars. No one knows really how bright that would be. That's one of the things people want to investigate over the next few years is, you know, how bright is the zodiacal light around other stars. So we know what kind of sensitivity we need to find planets around other stars. And instead of just saying planets around other stars, people say extrasolar, outside the sun, so, and exoplanet is the shorter term. So we'll talk about Kepler, and we'll talk about coronagraphs, and can't help but talk about total solar eclipses. That's a lot of things that we're learning about other stars and planets, teaches things about how we evolve and vice versa. We can look at things, occultations in our own and eclipses in our own solar system, and that'll give us a feel for how we go about searching for ones in other solar systems. So to start with, it would take something like a 30-40 meter telescope to actually image a planet around a nearby star. So when we talk about finding planets, it's really indirectly that we're sensing that they're there. So even something like Kepler just noticed a dimming as a planet goes in front of a star. It has to be lined up from looking from the Earth to these other stars. So we look at a bunch of stars at the same time, and we look for a dimming. So I'll talk about that in a little more detail. Another way is if you think about how you can hear a train coming towards you or away from you and hear the shift in sound. Well, a planet around another star is going to kind of shift how that star is moving and rotating, and so you get a little shift not of sound, but of light. So people look at radial velocity and figure out what's happening. If you have a really good telescope, you can physically see the star move due to planets around it. You might not see the planet, but you can see what's happening to the star. So a lot of things are just indirect. And another is, you've heard of, or may have heard of, micro lensing that you have such dense, high gravitational areas that light going by them bends. You can actually get a focusing. So light coming from something going by a high density area can cause a lensing, and then you see something there also. Some of the challenges, okay, Earth-like planet around our star, you know, you go outside, you hold up your thumb or your fist and block out the sun. How bright is the sun compared to a planet? Well, compared to an Earth-like planet, it's 10 orders of magnitude brighter. So we're trying to find something that's 10 billion times fainter than the star. So you've got to really block out that starlight to see the very dim stars around it. Even if we were looking for a Jupiter, it's 9 orders of magnitude. And that's all on the visible. If we shift to the infrared, hey, it gets 1,000 times easier. You only have to knock things down 7 orders of magnitude to find an Earth-type planet. Well, you look at how you get stray light around here, light bouncing off the walls and different things. So you get outside light from different outside lights, street lights, and that makes it hard to see the stars. Just think about trying to attenuate it by that amount. So that's a challenge. And there are other things when you look at instruments and speckle. You see little dots or patterns around there. You can do it in two wavelengths. It's kind of hard to see. I don't know, you can see the dimension. Right hand's better than the left. Those little dots are imperfections. You'll see that in looking through telescopes too. And so is it a little dot from the instrument, or is it actually a planet? So you can do things. You can take your telescope in space and rotate it and say, okay, the strange artifacts in the telescope should rotate as I rotate the telescope. But something else might have changed too. So we'll talk about how you can try to eliminate the effects of speckle to know what you're really getting. So now I'm backing up. We talk about finding planets around other stars. What is a star? So, what's the nearest star to us? Yes?
The sun.
The sun. That's right. The sun is the nearest star. And it probably doesn't look like that when you look outside. You think of it being yellow, it's really just, it's so bright, it's really light, but you can't look at it directly. And later, afterwards, you can take a look at, I've got some little eclipse glasses up here. These cut down the amount of light by a factor of 100,000, so you can safely look at the sun. So you don't want to look at the sun directly, unless it's a total eclipse.
Why can't you look at the sun directly?
Because you'll burn, it'll focus on the retina, and you'll get a burn, and one of the things you can get is too much ultraviolet. And I remember that in college, doing experiments, I got an ultraviolet suntan on the back of my eyeball. And so that's when I said, I'm going to stop wearing contacts when I do labs and to wear glasses. And that's also an interesting thing for people in college to correlate. Oh, gee, let's see, I was in physics lab 8 hours ago, and that's why I woke up in the middle of the night with a headache. Not your first guess. So you do want to be careful looking at the sun. You don't want to look at it directly. When it's really cloudy, you get near sunset or sunrise, and you can safely look for a few seconds. But when it's really bright and you want to look at eclipses, then you need special glasses unless it's completely blocked out. And I'll show you some pictures of when it's completely blocked out. And then you have to remember to take off those glasses or filters to really see the beauty of the corona of the sun. So, there's the sun. Nuclear fusion going on. All these explosions makes it really bright and gives us the warmth that we feel from here. And that's another interesting thing when we're looking for planets around other stars. A lot of them, there have been a lot of surprises. Well, there have been ones really close to their stars. And some of them, they go around their star in 3 days, 4 days, not a year like for the Earth, or tens of years for some of the planets. It's just amazing. And we've seen a lot of really big planets, bigger than Jupiter, detected them near other stars. But as time goes by and the techniques get better, then we're also finding ones like Earth. The big ones close in were easy to find.
Why don't they burn up?
The stars or the planets?
Planet.
Well, it depends on how close they are. And looking at Mercury, it's very hot, but it's not burning up. But there are ones even closer than Mercury to their stars. So there's some that can be, you know, certainly it wouldn't be habitable, not life like we would think of it. But they're still intact. Some of the ones close are rocky-type planets as opposed to gas giants like Jupiter and Neptune. But in our own solar system, when we're thinking about finding life, we think about an area about where Earth is, and you could think of Venus to Mars. There was life at one time on these. And it's more of the rocky-type planets like Venus and Mars and Earth. As you go out around the gas giants, you wouldn't think about finding life. However, if you look at their moons, like Europa, there's a question of whether there's life around Europa, moon of Jupiter, and our Enceladus around Saturn, they've seen water jets going out. So you see little geysers from some of the spacecraft that have gone out and are going around Saturn. They've actually flown through the plume of some of these geysers. So, you know, sometimes we'd like to send more instruments out to look at that, to Europa and to Jupiter. Part of the problem is it's really a high radiation field there, so our spacecraft and instruments don't last too long to do that. Okay, separate from the star, okay, a planet. Earth is a planet. What makes a planet a planet? Yes? Right, it orbits around the star, so the Earth is round from its gravity, its self-gravity, it accumulated material, and it formed into a round ball, and it goes around a star, it goes around the sun. And the other one that, the International Astronomical Unit made up, with some people agreeing and some people not, is that it should clear out its orbit. So there shouldn't be debris. If you look at the orbit around the star, there shouldn't be other things in there. It should have knocked them out and dominated its orbit. Now that's a recent decision. People at Southwest Research Institute in Boulder were the ones who came up with an idea of sending a spacecraft and instruments to Pluto. So that's called New Horizons, and Ball has an instrument on it called Ralph, an interesting name for instruments. And when that was launched, it was headed to a planet. Well, it gets there in 2 years, and darn, it's not a planet anymore. So Alan Stern, the principal investigator for that, he thinks this is a planet. And I'll talk a little bit later about Mike Brown at Caltech, doesn't think it should be a planet. But he also had interesting ideas for naming things. So actually, if you look now at a chart of the different planets, Pluto's still on there. It hasn't been deleted. You'll get people in the New York Planetarium. They got rid of it quite a while ago, so that was a controversy in the Planetarium. So it has a strange name here. So you'll see a lot of things labeled with a year and numbers and all. This right here is what Mike Brown and his team discovered, and it was about the same size as Pluto. And in fact, they thought it was bigger. Now they're not completely sure. And he also found another one even further out, in Sedna. And so they wondered, you know, was this the 10th planet? Are there more planets, or is this something else? And this object here in Pluto has some similarities. Now, it didn't start out with this kind of name. Has anybody seen the TV series at this point? It's probably reruns of Xena, Princess Warrior. That's what Mike called it, not officially. But it leaked out that he called that Xena, after Xena, Princess Warrior. He thought it should be named after a lady. And it has a moon. So, gee, if you name the planet, well, one thing is, Xena starts with an X, so it was Planet X, the planet they had been looking for. What was that other planet? So that was, it starts with an X for Xena. But the moon they named Gabriel. That was Xena's companion in the TV series. Well, officially they went back and forth, and as you were saying, there are three things to describe what a planet is now by the International Astronomical Union. They had a vote in Prague, and later other people voted on it. And they decided these are going to be called dwarf planets, but even though planets at the end, it's not a planet. So that's pretty much by definition that they came up with that. So now it's called Eris. E-R-I-S is the official name, except for when you're using numbers and all. And the moon is, I think it's Deucenia, which is the, Eris is a Greek goddess, Deucenia is the daughter of the Greek goddess. And by the way, Deucenia means lawlessness. Okay, who played Xena? Lucy Lawless. So there's a story behind these things. You've got to do something to make it interesting. You should see how much time we spend coming up with acronyms for names of proposals and instruments. Okay, looking at a planet going across a star, we look here. There is a round shadow. Or actually, it's, I guess that's the disk itself. That's a planet. So that's a planet. Since this was taken from here, from Earth, it has to be between us and the Sun. So that turns out to be Venus. And that was in 2012. And also in 2004, things lined up for what they were calling a transit of Venus. And it just means that Venus was between us and the Sun, and in doing that, we could learn things about how fast it's moving, its relative size. There are things you can learn as it goes across, and that same thing works for planets around other stars. Now, you can try to look at this again. Some of you have a chance. It's in the year 2117. So a lot of us aren't going to get to see that one. We saw this one last year, and it's a long time before it happens again. But last year at Ball Aerospace, a couple of us got out between buildings and got out cameras and little telescopes. And so I took this picture. Somewhere up here is a little dot. It's hard to see, but there's a little dot up here. That's Venus starting to go across. And they were wondering whether you would see the effects of the atmosphere of Venus when the Sun was just going around it. And then when it got back to Lafayette, it's getting lower, you can see tree limbs here in the way, and there's a dot again, and then it's getting even lower, and you can see it's getting closer to sunset. And then we can play this one. That'll show you the one in 2004, and see if you can see where Venus is. Is it at the top or bottom? Okay, let's play it one more time, so now you know where to look. There it is. So it's pretty hard to see. So think about how hard it is for something that's light years away. And it takes years for the light to get here, the star is far away. Kepler, hopefully you've heard about it. I mean, when we hear about it at work, that was built by Ball Aerospace, working with JPL and Ames, two NASA centers. Kepler is looking out at 130,000 stars or so. It's looking at one place and just staring at the same spot, or at least it was until a few months ago. And the idea was you want to look at a lot of stars, and hopefully something will line up. Because we didn't know how many planets there were. That idea, and that was something they wanted to find out. Trying to think of what would be targets for a terrestrial planet finder, which was envisioned at one time for an 8 to 10 meter aperture telescope in space. Their budgets are smaller now, so that's not going to happen anytime soon. But trying to find out what stars they could look at, what would be the right type of star to look at, and what would be the probability of finding an Earth-like planet. Just to understand a little bit more about Kepler, it's a Schmidt telescope, almost a meter in aperture. It's got a big lens in front, or a corrector plate. So there's something that's not just a flat window. It's got power, made of a strange material. And then the primary mirror is 1.45 meters in aperture, and it's made of ultra-low expansion glass by Corning, so ULE made by Corning. And a lot of telescopes are made of that type of glass. And Kepler doesn't really image things. It's got a lot of detectors, the biggest focal plane, number of pixels that's flying in space. But is it a giant photometer? It just gathers light and it tries to see when the brightness changes. You know, what they got dimmer. What made it get dimmer? Well, it could have been a sunspot. We see sunspots go across our sun and that changes the brightness. Could be something goofy in the instrument. I know there was one instrument that launched and some tape fell down in front of the detector. And they spent about a year trying to figure out how they could still get some science when you've got tape in front of your detector. So they weren't thrilled about that. So just looking at the difference, and it's trying to find something 20 or 30 parts in a million. So the goal was to be able to find something that was one part out of 100,000 in dimness. And this isn't like Hubble going around the Earth. It's going around the Sun and actually is trailing behind the Earth. So it was put in the same orbit as Earth is, slightly different, so it'll go around the Sun at a different rate. So that made it interesting. It's getting further and further from the Earth, so it's got further to send the information back to Earth. And that's a picture of it. It's two stories high, weighs over a ton, and then we have a lot of things wrapped around it to control the temperature. Because if you have temperature differences of one side of the telescope to the other side, it kind of messes things up. And you can get a feel for that if you go out in a hot parking lot and you look across and things kind of wiggle, or you look up at stars at night and things are twinkling. You can see the effects of having different atmospheric effects for index of refraction or just because things are different temperatures. And you have the same thing when your telescope kind of creaks around because the temperature is changing. No one. You can turn the
volume. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Engine start.
So this was 4 years ago.
0 and liftoff of the Delta II rocket with Kepler on a search for planets in someway like our own.
So this was a very lacking time, always when you spend a number of years working on something to see if it'll work.
Pressure's looking good. 1 second, another flight.
because sometimes things don't always make it to orbit. There've been a couple of things in the
recovering from the initial launch.
Last 5 years that are investigating the ocean.
Yes, in 34 seconds. Block one, vehicle now going supersonic. The motor chamber pressure is beginning to trail off as we're passing 45 seconds. Engine chamber pressure, good steady state value. Symmetrical burn on the groundlet solids. Coming up 55 seconds. Standing by for burnout. Burning out of solids. For separation. You see separation? And we have ignition of the airlit solid motors. Airlit solid motors building in chamber pressure.
Yeah, what happened on a couple of recent experiments, the fairing that was supposed to separate off didn't separate off. It affected things aerodynamically. So there were a couple of science experiments in recent years that didn't make it to orbit. So that was Kepler. You saw how it's a big telescope or a big photometer in space. So what you really get is that I look at a brightness curve, you know, like on a little chart or think of how something is plotted out, and then, oh, there's a little dip. Is that real? Is it not real? And so, depending on how big the planet is relative to the star, and there are apps for Kepler, so you can go on the Apple side, and there's one for exoplanets, and there's one for Kepler, and you can watch as it shows this going across and things changing. And also, the timing of how that happens, if it's not repeatable, could mean there's more than one planet going around here. So they look for multiple dips. They can look at how the timing of the transits change, and that can give them an indication that there are more than one planet in the areas. And Kepler, you may have read that it has to be very precisely pointed and extremely stable for it to be able to take this kind of data. It's got to have the star on the same pixel in the detector. It can't move around. And so there are controls for that, and there were four devices. They needed three. One died a while back, and the other died this year. So now there's only two of the attitude control systems working. It's not stable enough to do the same type of science. But they had a solicitation in the last couple of months. They got 50 or 60 different proposals from scientists about what can Kepler do, a giant telescope in space. And they're actually looking at, maybe they could look along the plane of our solar system and our galaxy and see small planets around small stars. So, there's still the possibility that Kepler will continue to take data to find new planets around other stars. And even if it doesn't take new data, they've got about two more years of reducing the data they already have. So they've got about 3,000 candidates that could be planets at this point. Only a couple hundred have been confirmed. But they think probably 90% of them are for real. So when we talked about transiting, you know, here's a star, here's the planet going around. So it goes in front and it blocks some of the starlight. As it's going around the back, what some experiments want to do in the future, and some are doing right now, is looking at the effects through the atmosphere as it goes around the back. So you can learn things when it goes in front, and you can learn things when it goes in back. So there's different signs that you can do. And we'll show some things for solar eclipses about emission spectra or absorption spectra. You can find out what things are made of. What they want to find out is what kind of atmospheres are around these planets, trying to characterize the size, can we learn about their density, and figure out, can they be like Earth? So when you see pictures like that, we thank the artist. That's not from the cameras that we have now. But it helps give a feel for, there are a lot of strange planets. that are out there. And we even found out that there are planets going around, some stars are in pairs, binary, so have two stars real close together. And at one time they thought, boy, how could you have a planet around that? It wouldn't be stable. But they found planets going around pairs of stars. So we go back to Star Wars, and they're looking up, and they're, other planets, and double planets, or double stars, I should say. That could be real. Now, looking at from here, what can we see sort of occulting, blocking the sun? This is the moon going across between the Earth and the sun. And as it blocks it, there's some sunspots. You can see things on the sun. And as the moon goes across, sometimes it just, this is as much as it blocks it, because things don't line up perfectly. Sometimes, because the moon isn't always the same distance from the Earth, and the Earth isn't always the same distance from the sun exactly, sometimes the moon exactly blocks out the sun. Sometimes it's a little smaller appearing, and sometimes it's larger. So you get different types of eclipses. So you can have a partial eclipse. You can have an annular where the moon fits in, but you can see the sun all the way around. You still need to wear your solar eclipse glasses to look at it. And then you have a total eclipse, then it's safe to look at it with your eye or through binoculars or a telescope just during the short time of the total eclipse. And the longest that is 7 minutes. So in 2009, there was an eclipse that was almost 7 minutes, about 6 minutes, 40-something seconds. That's the longest for this entire century. And then they can be as short as, you think it was plus or minus a second. I read some reports, because a week and a half ago, there was one over Africa. And so last year, you can see an annular eclipse in the United States. So this was in Albuquerque. From here, we just saw a partial eclipse. Things didn't line up just right. But in Albuquerque, you can see here's the sun before. So this was taken with a solar filter over the camera to reduce the brightness. Here's the moon coming in, and the moon continuing to come in. And now it's right in the center, and then it continues off on the other side. So those are pictures. My son and I went to Albuquerque. We went to the Balloon Museum, which is an interesting museum, if you ever see this, for hot air balloons. And there were a lot of people. It was very busy. And again, just remember, unless it's a total eclipse, and this isn't, you always had to have protective filters or eyeglasses during that entire thing. And now this is what happens when there's a total eclipse. It's almost, the moon's almost completely blocking out the sun, and you get what they call a diamond ring, because there's this bright spot, so you have this band around it, and a really bright spot there. And you can see little flares and other things around it. And the moon isn't perfectly round. There are mountains and valleys. So sometimes you see a little bright spot peeking through. So those are called Bailey's beads. So you look for a diamond ring, and you look for these little beads. And when it's total, you look for little flares. And then the outer atmosphere, the corona, which you can't see unless the central part is blocked, because this is, it seems bright here, but it's so much dimmer than the surface of the sun that you don't see it except in the eclipse. Or you have an instrument that blocks that out, and that's what a coronagraph does. You're blocking out the bright side. And that corona can go way outside what you think of as the sun. Now this is a picture, this is something that you can see with your eye, but it's hard to capture with a camera. So what some people do is line up, and Gary Emerson worked at Ball Aerospace, you take different exposures. And so one part will get the dim part out here, and another can get brighter areas. So you do a composite superimposing multiple exposures. So this was in 1991, and that eclipse was almost 7 minutes. So I think Gary was in Mexico. And my wife and I were in Hawaii. We weren't right on the center line, so we saw a 99% eclipse and very good weather. And on the big island of Hawaii, they saw clouds in 100% dark through the clouds. Okay, this was taken a week and a half ago in Uganda. So this was there's a website called the Astronomy Picture of the Day. And so you can search for that. It's in NASA. Every day they have a different picture. And so this was about a week ago. And this shows how, since it was only a 20-second eclipse, I think where they were, it was only dark for 20 seconds. It means that the moon and the sun were almost a perfect fit as far as the angle. You know, the physical size isn't the same, but the angle that you're looking at from Earth is the same size. So you got to see things all the way around at the same time. So that was very impressive. And using an instrument like a prism or a grating, there is someone else, and this was on the website today. That's what the total solar eclipse looked like. And then just think of this as a bright ring or a slit. When you look at that arc, that's what's getting imaged over here. So you're getting a hydrogen line, H-alpha line, and another hydrogen line, helium line. So you can actually tell something about emission spectrum. You don't have the bright disk of the sun, which would absorb things, and you get absorption spectra, you actually find out what's emitting. Oops, too far. That's what the surface of the sun looks like, colors like that. So we learned a lot. When you look at the sun in a normal situation, and then you learn other things when you look at it during an eclipse. So again, just another picture of what an eclipse looks like in the corona. And looking at it again, this we were talking about, just as it was, the photosphere, looking at the emission lines from the photosphere. That's what you saw was the spectrum before, and looking at the corona going out. And then you can look at it in different wavelengths. Looking at it in X-rays, actually, in X-rays you can see things on the surface of the sun, not just the corona around it. Yes?
What is the corona exactly?
So the corona is just like when we think about Earth has different levels of atmosphere, and we can give different names to different heights of the atmosphere, like troposphere, stratosphere. So this is just the atmosphere of the sun going far out from the disk. So you think of the photosphere as this part, the chromosphere right near the edge. And then the corona is what we call it, real far away from it. Now, not always wanting to wait for an eclipse, because that happens every year or two. The next one's in 2015, like up near the Faroe Islands, so the weather is probably going to be bad. You could actually build an instrument where you put an occulting disk in it and try to block out the sun. When you talk about coronagraphs, one of the things is how is it blocking it? How close to the star can you see things? What's the inner working angle? What's the outer working angle? But what it really means is how close to a sun could I see something to a star? So this is on SOHO. So this is orbiting, looking at the sun. It's still operating. LASCO is an instrument, and this is just looking at two different sized disks. So you're blocking out maybe something that's 3 to 5 times the size of the sun versus something that's maybe blocking out 30 times the size of the sun, so that you can see different features around it. Just like we talked about taking different time exposures, this is sort of a way to get more information. Okay, this is another one of those goofy charts that I wasn't supposed to put in, but I couldn't help myself. So if you look at something on the image plane of an instrument, you'll see a bright image, and then you get these little rings that go out from it. So you talk about a point spread function, and there's your star. And how close can you see something to this bright image. So you're trying to block this out and see something dim away from it. And depending on your type of instrument, you can see closer in. You know, some instruments wouldn't be able to see Venus, might not see Earth, but they can see Jupiter, something that far away. Say Jupiter is 5 times the distance from the Sun that the Earth is. So what we're doing is putting a little disc there, like your thumb or hand, to block out the bright star. But then, you know, if you look at a street light, it depends on what kind of glasses you have, and you have contacts, you see these little spikes going out sometimes, or you look at things through a screen, you get diffraction. Well, scattered light's going to go out. And we just talked about how scattered light, if you're trying to see something 10 billion times dimmer, it doesn't take much scattered light to obscure the planet you're looking for. So you put something here that goes outward instead of at the center to try to block that. So that's some of the things that are going on with instruments for coronagraphs. So you're trying to block out the star and also take care of the diffraction. There are a lot of people that have studies right now that are ongoing. I guess for the last 3 or 4 years, we had one study at Ball where we were working with Princeton and JPL trying to figure out how to get rid of that thing and call it speckle so that you could tell what the planet was. And there are other things. You just make strange shapes and try to throw the starlight out somewhere where it doesn't bother you. So maybe you throw it all out in this direction and that direction, but you've got this area and this area where you can see something dim like a planet. So this is just to let you know there are a lot of different ideas and ways to do it. Things 5 or 10 years ago, they felt, well, this would never work. Now they're thinking, oh, there's some ways we can do this on the ground. This is a velocity vortex coronagraph. That sounds like a racing name. Does something with polarization. This is where the star really is, but you don't see it because that light's been canceled out. And you can see 3 planets around it. So now you can actually directly see something. Instead of just the effect on the star, you're actually sensing where the planets are. Okay, we've got telescopes here. You can, with the telescopes and the right filters, look at eclipses, partial and total. But again, remember the right type of protective filters or glasses. So sunglasses won't work. Someone wondered if they stacked up 10 sunglasses in a row, would that be good enough? Now, that's not good enough. 20 sunglasses, then you look a little weird and you tip over. But there are strange people that go to look at these solar eclipses. So there's two of those are brothers that we've seen on, I think it was 3 eclipses, and they have their viewing glasses, so they've got the dark film. You can buy sheets of film that you can put over binoculars or telescope, and you can buy glass filters with the right kind of density that also works. So this is on a ship off the coast of Egypt, and there were people all lined up here with their telescopes, and people down here with their telescopes. So this was the picture I took that was, we were off the coast of Iwo Jima, so we were near Japan when we saw this, and so there's my wife, who's in the back of the room being quiet, right here looking through this filter. They're looking at the harsh before it's total. And if you've heard about pinhole cameras, that's a safe way to look at what's happening with the sun, is to take a piece of cardboard and put a small hole in it, and then you can get an image of the sun and look at that. Well, you can also take off your watch and the little holes in there, that works. This lady took off her straw hat, and there are all these little crescents that are looking like partial suns being imaged. Someone else crossed their fingers. So there are a lot of things. There weren't many trees on the ship. If you're in a place with trees, you look through the leaves, where the leaves are, look at the shadow on the ground, and you'll see all these crescents from from the sun as it's starting to change. And the temperature drops a lot too, because there have been times like earlier tonight it was cloudy and then it's getting clearer. There have been times where 3 minutes before the total eclipse, there were clouds and we thought we weren't going to see anything, and the temperature dropped as the sun's being blocked and the clouds disappeared. So at the last minute we were saved. This was last year in Australia. We went out to an island off Cairns, so in Queensland, and we got there in the dark. We took a boat out an hour or two out to this island, small island, less than a mile across. Walked across in the dark, and the eclipse started less than 10 minutes after sunrise. So we saw lots of stars, and also some lots of clouds, and we were thinking it's going to be pretty low in the sky. And it was interesting. This is the person next to us, set up on the sandy beach. You see a wall there. But the water used to be 100 feet on the other side of the wall. So it was interesting watching people pick up their tripods and run as the water started moving in. During the time we were there, the water changed 9 feet in height. 9 feet in height on something that's almost level, a really shallow beach, changes where you are a lot. So we got up near where the driftwood was, because we knew what we were looking for. So here's looking with image stabilized binoculars, but with a special filter taped over the front. And then when it was total, you take the filter off. And this was taken through a camera with some magnification with the filter on it. This was a different camera when it was dark, because sometimes you forget to take the filter off. And you get lots of pictures that just look like it's black background. So there's a little black dot in there. So some of the times it's good to know people who take a lot of pictures, and you can just look at it yourself. You can look with binoculars or observe instead of spending all the time looking for something. Okay, this is again patterns where you can see the speckle of the instrument, and I won't go into this in more detail, but that's what our study was looking at, were ways to characterize that, figure out what was happening, and something that would work quickly on orbit so that you could look at more places in the sky and look at more science objects quickly and figure out what was the planet, what was the instrument effect, what was scattered light, background light. And so that's one of the things we're working on. And there are some systems that have deformable mirrors, what some people call rubber mirrors, where you can change the shape and you can correct for that. So we were working with JPL. They have some test beds with deformable mirrors in them. So what we were trying to do is to look at where we have a dark area. Light would be over here where the star would be, and we could look over here for a dim planet, and we could sense things that were about 9 orders of magnitude dimmer than the light source we were simulating in the lab. This is a test bed at Princeton University, and so we were working with a professor there and a number of his grad students. And some of them, Elizabeth Young was doing a lot of this, and she was making these coronagraphic masks, so she was doing photolithography to make masks. And actually in January, she starts as a physics professor where I went to school in Memphis. Another way to do it is, like we again said, we just block out the sun. Here's a bright star, here's a telescope, like James Webb Space Telescope. And if I could block this out, I don't have to make a super good telescope or the mirrors as precise. I just have something fly up and get between me and the star. And so this is something that Webcash at CU came up with this idea, and there are a number of test beds going on to look at the technology of how to make the occulting disk, because the star shade isn't just round, it's got little petals, so that diffraction throws the light away from the center of the disk instead of something ending up in the center. What I didn't say is this is about 40 meters across, so way over 100 feet across. Oh, and the distance from here to here is 40,000 kilometers. So this is really an interesting way to look at it. You'd have to have two launches or something that could carry two large things, and then they'd have to be at different places in space. And then you would have to fly this to different parts of the sky relative to the telescope to look at things. But this is something that's being studied. In the future, there are existing telescopes. You see a bunch of the 8-meter aperture telescopes that are, three of these are in Hawaii, though some have multiple ones in other places too. But we're looking at ones for the future to try to find planets and characterizing from the Earth. You can't do as much from the atmosphere, but you can still do things with adaptive optics to those rubber mirrors to correct the effects of the twinkling atmosphere. But there's some giant telescopes being discussed now and actually starting. A 30-meter telescope is something that a bunch of organizations in the U.S. are looking at. In Europe, they have the European Extremely Large Telescope. Now, it's getting downsized. It was 42 meters, now it's going to be 39. Now, that sounds large, but they were smart. They had a 100-meter one before they were proposing to make one, 100 meters across. And so what would you call something if this is extremely large? That one was called OWL, O-W-L, overwhelmingly large. Overwhelmingly large telescope, and it had an overwhelmingly large cost. So now it's downsized to extremely large. That's like the Hubble Space Telescope. It used to be the large space telescope. It was LST. It was going to be 3 meters in size and then shrunk to 2.4. And then there's another telescope, University of Arizona is working at this. If you've ever gone to University of Arizona or you see on TV they're playing football, well, underneath that football stadium, they're making 8-meter size mirrors. They're pouring in a bunch of borosilicate chunks of glass, melt it, and then they spin this giant chamber and it makes it curved like a mirror should be, and then they'll spend months and months letting it slowly cool into that shape, and then they'll go polish it. So they are looking at having 7 8-meter telescopes, mirrors, that are all together here. So 8-meter, 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 and ones all around. These are made of about 1 to 1.5 meter segments, so it's an array of mirrors, not a single one. And thinking of an array, here's James Webb Space Telescope. That's 6.6 meters across. Hubble is 2.4, so this is going to be much bigger. And also, it's bigger than would fit in, you saw Kepler and a Delta II rocket. Will this one even fit in an Atlas V or Delta IV, the things that have 4 or 5 meter shrouds, since this is 6.6 meters, and at one time it was going to be over 8 meters in size, so again, things shrunk a little with some budget. This has to be folded up, it's like a tabletop. So we'll see in a little movie how there's two wings, and the wings are folded back in case wind didn't come up, you didn't want it blocking. So you've got a number of segments, these segments are 1.3 meters flat to flat on a hexagon, so hexagon shaped. And so they fold out, and then they align themselves up and down so that the wings and the center part all match. So they have to be, a fifth of an inch, half an inch, or 5 millimeters that they have to go this way. And then we want to get them to about a 40th or a 50th, a 60th of the wave of light. We then align them to 10 nanometers. So a billionth of a meter is what we're going to align one segment to the other. So it's like one giant mirror. And these are made of beryllium, which is lighter than aluminum, And then we take about 90% of the weight out of if it was a solid beryllium disk. So we lightweighted a lot so that this entire mirror at 6.6 meters weighs about what the Hubble telescope, 2.4 meter primary mirror weighs. That was the only way to be able to get enough mass into space. See the movie on that? So James Webb is going to be 1.5 million kilometers away from Earth. So it's going to be, or a million miles. It's going to be on the other side of the moon. You think of the moon being 240,000 miles away. This is going to be a million miles away. So it's not 200 or 300 miles away like Hubble in orbit around the Earth. It's going out beyond the moon so that, and it has this giant shield you see deploying here. This shield has 5 layers, and that's going to block the heat from the sun, from the Earth, from the moon, and then the telescope can then look out into dark space. But as it goes around the sun, it can see a lot of different stars, different times of the year. So now you've got the sun shield out. The secondary mirror just came out to here. So the light comes in, hits the primary, hits the secondary, goes through the center here, hits the third mirror. It's a fine steering mirror, and then goes down to instruments. So there are a lot of mechanisms and deployments, and a lot of work has gone into testing and verifying that all of that's going to work. So I want to end on one thing, since eclipses are interesting to see. In a little less than 4 years, there's going to be a total solar eclipse. The shadow is going to go across the United States, and it's going to be just north of us here in Wyoming. And maximum durations around in this area near Illinois and Kentucky, and it'll be about 2 minutes and 40 seconds long. So it might be 20 seconds longer here than over here, but I kind of think the weather is going to be better over where we are than over in this area. So that's something to think about. In 2017, you don't have to travel far to be able to see a total solar eclipse.
Where are you going to stake your spot out?
I'm thinking up here. And then a few years, I figure whether it's 5 years, 7 years after, there's another one that's going to kind of go this way. It kind of crosses somewhere in Illinois. So there'll be another chance in the near future. Because I don't think there's been, it's been a while since the total was
going on. That's the first one since what, 91?
Yeah, 91 was, that's at least North America, around in Mexico. So that was a 7-minute one. And then the 2006 was kind of the same pattern of having a real long solar eclipse.
Why is the time of the eclipse different?
Again, it depends on the relative distance of the moon from the Earth. So if the moon in its orbit around the Earth happens to be a little bit closer, it'll block out, the angle will seem bigger. It'll block out the sun for longer. So the sun will move in within the bigger shadow, and it can take as long as 7 minutes. The one in Africa was about, some people went for 7 seconds, some saw 20 seconds. Some people flew east of, I think it was east of Bermuda, and they're still arguing whether they saw 1 second or it was minus a second, whether they really saw it, or they're trying to figure that out. And there were people in Africa that were all ready to see things, and a sandstorm came up. So they didn't see anything. When that hit, there were some people, there was one guy from the University of Arizona, had 2 planes waiting, because he always has a backup plan. And so they planned to see it from the ground. When the storm cleared enough that they could, well, first they jumped in the planes just a few seconds before the sandstorm hit the airport. And then it subsided enough they could take off. So they actually saw the eclipse from 2 small planes.
And he was talking about, he was working with the pilot to line up. They didn't exactly do things the way they planned with the timing of the sandstorm and all. And he said he didn't have enough time to really get back to look out a window. He was going to look out a window behind the cockpit, and the angle was such he was blocked. So he dived. He ran to the back, dived across two seats, and looked out a window and just forgot about the camera, telescope, or anything. He just watched it with his eyes. So. And he was the one who organized it. So he kind of sacrificed some of his viewing. But I think he's got this to say. That's Glenn Schneider. He's got the, I think, second most time under the shadow of the umbra. Okay, any questions? That was the last slide, was to get you ready to go out. You have plenty of time to plan. You can get your binoculars, your special glasses.
Have we completely given up on Kepler?
No. They're looking at, even though there's only two reaction wheels working, there are science that can be done with it. We think they can still find exoplanets with Kepler. So we can't do. It's not going to look in the same region that it did before and just look at those hundred or something thousand stars. And the reason it was trying to look for so long is some planets go around their star in 3 or 4 days, Earth a year. What they kind of had in mind is to find Earth-sized planets. They'd like to do it for at least 2 years, three would be better. They'd like to detect it three times, because if they only see it once, maybe it was there, maybe it wasn't, maybe it was a sunspot, maybe other stars lined up behind it, and I'm seeing one star block another star. So they'd like to be able to detect it three times to have confidence that it's real. So they are still thinking that in an extended mission, they've got to get new funding or approval. So it'll go to a NASA senior review. But it looks like it still will be able to do some research on finding new planets. So there's some people want to find planets, other people want to characterize the planets that already exist, and there's another experiment that will probably launch in 3 years or so that's going to characterize planets. So that's called TESS. And we also were on a study, because I worked on the proposal, we got a study for about a year to look at an experiment that would have had about a 0.7-meter telescope in space to characterize the atmosphere. So that was called FINESSE. So it made it to the study phase, but they chose TESS. But they did choose an exoplanet, so there's a lot of interest in finding the exoplanets.
Yes?
Steve, since you'll be going about 70 minutes, I think we should give people a chance to stretch their legs.
Yep.
And then maybe after...
I can answer questions.
After we do that, maybe you can explain also a little bit to the people interested what all the props are that you brought on the table there. Yep. Anybody who wants to go observe from the telescope, there will be volunteers at the telescope, so let's give Steve a hand. Thank you.